Bridging the Generation Gap is supported by Tompkins Vist Bank.
Good morning and welcome to this episode of Bridging the Generation Gap. I'm your host, Jesse Pryor. Today we're going to be talking about the changing aspect of social media with some of our friends from Conrad Weiser High School. I'm a systems engineer, but I do keep myself up in the news as much as I can. The way that you access news today has been changed greatly. The number of sources, the 24-hour news cycle, all of these things affect how we absorb our news, how it affects our opinions. There's been a great concern, of course, about fake news, checking sources, understanding context. It's quite an interesting time right now in terms of the media. Many sources, from social media to newspaper, print is still out there. Of course, the nightly news, the morning news, just all kinds of things going on right now. So just waiting for my friends at Conrad Weiser to join me. But I am an engineer by training, and that's what I do. So as that, I tend to do a lot of critical thinking, a lot of analysis for things like that. Anyway, I'd like to welcome the group from Conrad Weiser. Hello, everyone. And I apologize for just a moment, guys. We don't have any sound. Hang on just a sec while we see if we can fix that. And we're
good?
There we go. Hey, I got you. Hey.
All right. So we're going to start by introducing ourselves.
Yeah, go for
Casey.
It.
Hi, I'm Jacob.
Hey, Jacob.
How you doing? I'm Ethan.
Hi, Ethan.
Hi, I'm Austin.
Hey, Austin.
Hi, I'm William.
Hey, William.
And I'm Matt.
Hey, Matt. How's everybody doing this morning?
I'd say we're very good.
Good.
I'd say pretty good.
Yeah. Enjoying the warmer weather.
Right outside, but that's fine.
So you're all up, I assume, on today's topic, which is the changing aspect of media, both as it relates to social media and the news. Coincidentally, the last time I talked to you, we talked a lot about social media. So I'd like to try to focus a little bit more on the news aspect of it this time around. And going around the room here, I'm sure that there's a lot of different opinions, a lot of different thoughts on this. But generally speaking, how do you get your news? Do you do social media? Do you visit certain websites? Do you actually read a paper? Do you actually watch some news TV or some news shows? Just kind of going around, what's your favorite way to get it?
So for me, I don't really look at the news too much, but when I do, I get it through my school and my classes, maybe my government class. So that's mainly where I'll get all my news from.
Okay.
That's pretty much it for me.
I am almost strictly like off of news websites, so like NewYorkTimes.org or ABC. I like to look at a lot of variety, so I do look at Fox News and CNN, so I try to get a variety of news from online.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm kind of in the same boat as Casey. I don't really tend to look at the news too much just because I think nowadays there definitely is a bias, and I feel like you really have to dig in deep if you want to find something legit or like actually factual. But, you know, sometimes I get other news from social media, like Twitter or Facebook sometimes.
Okay. You know?
With Jacob, I use mostly news websites, and I try and check it like once a day, but sometimes it ends up being every other day.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm with most of the other guys here. I agree with Ethan. I said that I believe that like a lot of the news is biased nowadays, so you really have to do your research, but I do enjoy watching CNN.
Okay, so you do like CNN, all right.
I get most of my news from school, and some of it is from Twitter, but I try not to because you have to be careful with what you see on social media now because most of it is actually fake. But you have to use common sense when you see those things because if it is fake, it's often ridiculous.
Well, that's true. I would agree with that. Anybody else?
So I think that's everyone.
All right, so when we're talking about that very last statement there, which is a very interesting one, and talking about using common sense to discern fake news, which some of it, you're right, is pretty obvious, some of it maybe not so much. How do you do that? How do you analyze your news and understand its context and its validity? How do you fact check your news?
Well, for me personally, whenever I look at any news source, I look at who's writing it, like what side am I on? Because if I'm on Fox, it's most likely going to be more conservative, and if I'm on CNN, it's most likely going to be more liberal. So I look at the biases and I say, okay, how does this affect the article itself? And what I also like to do, I like to look up the same topic the article is covering on other news sites, seeing, you know, what facts are they saying together, and like what are they leaving out or what are they adding in. So that's a good way I like to, you know, fact check my news.
Okay.
Yeah, and with me, it's kind of like Jacob. If there's a news thing that comes out, I try to find just generally what happened. Like, what was the situation? Biases aside, whether or not it's conservative, liberal, or whatever, just what actually happened and how do I look at that situation personally?
But how do you find that out? How do you determine what the actual facts are?
Yeah, well, that's the thing. You gotta, you know, do a lot of research and just try to get as much information from as many sites as you possibly can, you know, depending on the situation, because there's some stuff that like really interests me, and then there's other stuff that's just like I don't really care too much about looking into it. So
okay, do you have qualifications for what you do care about and what you don't?
Yeah, I do, kind of. Like, there's just some stuff that doesn't interest me, and then there's other stuff that does.
Okay, anybody else on both of those, both the fact checking and the types of news that you like?
I agree with what Jacob said. You really have to check both sides of the story. So, like, he used CNN and Fox as examples. You really have to go to multiple websites or multiple sources to find what actually happened. You need to fact check with at least two or three different sources.
And I'm going to back up just a step here, because you're all kind of hinting around how you do your fact-checking, but what I'm curious about, are there any specific sites that you go to that you know are reasonably unbiased that you do use for fact-checking? And for example, there's a few kind of relatively well-known ones up there. There's PolitiFact, which does fact-checking on politics. There's Snopes, which does a lot of fact-checking on a breadth of anything. And there's several up there. Factcheck.org, I believe, is one. Are you familiar with any of those, and do any of you guys use those regularly?
I do not, no. I've never used any of those.
Okay. Anybody else?
So I do use Politico sometimes, especially like when, you know, people, like, especially when things get muddied up, like in like news articles, so like things involving politics, like, you know, scandals or, you know, what was said or policies that are being made. I like to make sure what I'm reading, because, you know, a lot of news sites, they're not going to go for the not honest, but like the more like straightforward answer if they can make it, you know, appealing, because in this day and age, what gets attention is what gets, you know, noticed, which gets money, which, you know, helps the news site, which is encourages them to start the cycle over again. So it's not necessarily about what's completely honest, it's more about what gets attention. So I do use Politico in cases like that.
Okay. Anyone else over there?
I think, yeah, I think we covered the bases.
Okay.
On like...
All right, so we're supposed to be bridging the generation gap here, and one of the things that's, you know, I reluctantly admit that I'm actually older than the internet. So back when I was a kid, it was the news on TV or newspapers. That was pretty much it. All of you live at home, and I would expect that at least some of you do discuss news stories with your parents and your family. How do you see the differences between the way you absorb news and the way they do?
I'll start it off again. So I get my information off of the internet. Like, I don't read the newspaper a lot unless it's for like the comics, but but that's besides the point. But my mom, on the other hand, she only uses the internet for like Facebook, which is, you know, that's great. She can connect with older friends, but she also gets her news from the newspaper. So it's very, like, she'll tell me like an event that happened, like, you know, say yesterday or something that just got published. And I'm like, Mom, I already know about that. It's really hard to, like, you know, find stuff out together. But it's interesting because, like, you know, you hear a lot of people complain, like, oh, kids are always on their phones these days. Well, it's like, you know, some of these kids are actually, like, looking at how things are happening. But it is an interesting dynamic seeing, like, you know, old and new.
Yeah. Any other experiences out there? Does anybody have a family that regularly watches the nightly news at dinner or something like that?
My family does not do that, but we, like my parents, my brother and sister, we all get our news from the internet, basically. Sometimes my mom and dad will watch like 69 News or something like that, but they never really watch the bigger news channels on TV or read the newspaper because I don't even know if we get the newspaper anymore.
Ah.
But it's sometimes really hard to talk about the news with them because we have pretty opposite political viewpoints, and they get their news from one source that might have one bias, and I get mine from another that has another bias. And even though, like, we try as hard as we can to fact check, sometimes we still have to argue over things.
Well, yeah, I've experienced that myself personally. Do you have, without getting into too many specifics, because I don't want to put anybody on the spot, but do you have, like, what are those leaning differences? I mean, my gut would say that your parents probably lean more conservative and you probably lean more liberally, but is that accurate?
Yeah, that's pretty accurate.
Okay. when you talk about these differences in the liberal bias versus the conservative bias, one of the most important things I've come across is the importance of basing your discussions on the facts. It seems important to me to agree on the facts of a situation, and then your liberal or conservative bias would be your perspective on it and what a possible solution or outcome or effect on the society might be. I have come across scenarios where it's difficult to agree on what the actual facts are. And I'm curious what your experiences are between you and your parents, your peers, when you're discussing these different scenarios and these different outcomes and these different things that happen. How do you guys agree on the facts before you start discussing the policies and the opinions that come with it?
A lot of the times we just have to go back to our sources and fact check them, like, together. Like, if me and Jacob were talking about the news and we disagreed on something, we would go back and find several websites that would back us up or go against us. We don't just keep arguing until one of us submits. We go back and fact check to make sure something is right.
Okay. But can you guys agree on the fact checking? And go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yeah, we tend, like, if one of us finds, like, a site where it's, like, you know, it's mostly non-biased or it's, like, Politico or something, and it's an official, and it says, you know, Austin's viewpoint was right, I think we, are, like, as, you know, a generation can acknowledge that, hey, our source was wrong, and, you know, look at the bigger picture. But I think a huge issue with, not issue, but I think a huge problem, not problem, but, like, something that occurs today is that news today is so fast that by the time you're done fact-checking, you know, these multiple sites, something new has already come out, or, like, a new development on the issue has come out. So I think that's something that's very different, like, from today, because, like you said, like, TV and newspaper, that's very slow. And even before that, when it was radio, or, like, when people got their news from going to the movies, like, that has completely changed in today's standards. Like, we've become so fast oriented when it comes to information that I think it comes up a lot.
Right. The 24 hour instant news cycle, right. Which is an interesting thing that's definitely become much more common recently than it has back in my day when that just didn't even exist. I read an interesting article recently, and I'd be curious to know what you guys think about this. I was reading an article about a guy who kind of did a self-study. He kind of personally looked into this, and he was curious what he did. is he turned off all the 24-hour news he could. He stopped looking at social media. He stopped looking at his Twitter feed. He didn't look at any online articles or anything that was posted immediately. All he did was he got the paper and read it, and that was it. He got like three or four subscriptions, like the Kid, New York Times, and Wall Street Journal, and I don't remember what else, two or three different ones. And what he discovered with a slower news cycle is that he got much more vetted, fact-checked information with a lot less bias. It was very thoroughly put together. It was put in context, which I think is probably our biggest detriment in the 24-hour news cycle, is we don't always get context. And he did that for a couple of months, and he realized that his worldview changed significantly with a much more thorough, slower news cycle with a lot more vetting, a lot more fact-checking. Is that something you guys might be willing to consider trying, or do you think maybe your parents do that?
I would be very interested in trying that. However, I don't know if I have the self-control enough to limit my news to the paper for, you know, 3 to 4 months. Like, that's especially, like, I've been conditioned to, like, you know, look up news, not conditioned, but, like, you know, raised in an environment where, like, getting your news 24/7 is just, that's the norm. Like, that's what people do. So it'd be very interesting, and I'd love to try it, but I'm not sure if I'd be able to follow through on it all the way.
Okay.
See, our generation is just, it's just muscle memory for us to be online and connected with everything, and we're constantly online, and I just feel that it's muscle memory for us now to just check our phones, check websites, check Instagram, Twitter, everything. I don't think we could easily get accustomed to checking the newspaper. I would love to try it, but it just would take a lot of work and self-control.
Right.
I just don't think we could do it as a generation.
Well, I understand that you get a lot of news pop-ups and alerts and stuff. I mean, I do too. So I definitely understand where that's going, but I was raised in a generation that didn't have that, so I'm adapting, whereas it seems like kind of right out of the gate, you just go.
Yeah, and as technology is advancing, the news is getting faster, media is getting a lot bigger, and new things are coming out. It's just going to keep growing from there.
Okay. Any other thoughts on that from the crew? No? Everybody's quiet?
No, I think that's it.
So, how about lately in terms of stories that you might be following? Is there anything of particular interest or any story that any of you have seen lately that you think is noteworthy, raises an eyebrow, is particularly interesting for any reason?
So in one of like the, you know, the 24-hour news cycle, and, you know, I think right now I've been following the President Trump, you know, the Mueller investigation, all of that. I've been following that very, very, you know, thoroughly, because I think that's extremely, you know, it's interesting to say the least.
That I'll give you.
But the issue with the 24-hour news cycle, it's like, you know, Trump says one thing, immediately the news cycle reports on it, but it turns out his team says something else, or it's like he didn't mean it like that, and it takes a little bit for that corrective information to come out, and that causes, you know, that first article causes immediate bias, because the people who want to read bad about Trump go to sites that report bad on Trump, and the people who want to read good about Trump go to sites that report good on Trump. And it's, so, you know, Donald Trump could probably say the same thing, one side would condemn it, the other side would praise it, and, you know, with the 24-hour news cycle, they're going to say they're going to report on it without checking their facts. So it's already causing more biases and a lot more misguided information going around.
Yep. Or shortened, non-contextual information. I see a lot of those on Facebook. I see a lot of people who post really quick memes of an event. Well, a meme has no information whatsoever. It's not been fact-checked. It's just a snippet of information with no context. And sometimes it's not even true. Actually, I think more often than not, it's not even true.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like, in today's, like, media, it's like, What can I say that will get attention, that will get clicks, that will get people to visit my website? And it's become, you know, quantity over quality. So we're getting a lot more you know, articles and, you know, memes and, you know, information, but it's not necessarily good information.
I would agree with that. That's very common out there. And I'd be curious to get your opinion on this. Would you say, or how would you feel about saying that a lot of these things, these clicks, the information that what they're trying to spread, get out there really quickly, might be more for ad and revenue generation than for actual facts?
Oh, I completely agree. I think today, especially our media has been so, you know, it's been encouraged
I got you.
to go the more monetary routes with, you know, getting clicks. Because if you're not the guy, if you're not the website getting, if you're taking your time to put out, you know, fact-checked articles, you know, unbiased articles, but you're not getting as many views or clicks or, you know, visits as, you know, your competitors, you're lagging behind. And today, especially, it's like, if you're not in front, you're doing something wrong. So I think a lot of media has taken that to heart, where it's been, what can I do to get ahead? And I think, you know, choosing quantity over quality and misinformation and, you know, putting biases towards the people who, you know, want to read those biases, I think that has become, it's definitely, you know, caused the general public as a whole to trust media a lot less.
What's your perception, and for the whole group there, what's your perception of just how trustworthy media is right now in terms of news reporting?
I always read media with a grain of salt. Like, I will believe that information until it gives me a reason not to, which a lot of times it gives me a reason not to.
Okay.
I just don't like to believe what the news has to say until it's proven throughout different news sources, and because I've seen so many things that have said to be true but they're really not, and it's just these bizarre things that happen, and I just don't like to look at the news that way.
Okay.
Somebody's yeah, talking. And I think the news, one of the things like I don't like about the news is everything is so politicized now. Even on a situation that happens that doesn't necessarily have to be politicized, it will get politicized, and I find it annoying.
Okay, annoying. All right.
Yeah, well, I agree again with most of the guys here. I believe a lot of the news media is like an arms race of who can have the best quality over quantity over quality. And it's very hard to trust that when they're trying to compete to get like the most revenue, like you said, and you can't really trust it that much.
Any other thoughts on that over there?
So regarding like fake news and things like that, I mostly use Twitter, and when I use Twitter, I use it for basically a laugh. I don't use it to find serious information. Like if I want to do that, I find that in school with teachers. We watch CNN student news, which I know can sometimes be biased, but the student news actually tends to do a pretty good job of not being biased. But yeah, when I'm on Twitter, like, I just try to find things that I will enjoy, that entertain me, and it does a pretty good job of that. But also, when I see like fake news and stuff, I don't take it to heart, because I know most of it, and especially if it just came out, I can't like take that to heart, because if I see it maybe like a week ago and there's all these different sources and things linked to it, then I can believe that.
Okay.
Just going off of what Matt said, like how he talks about like CNN student news and all that, Google News is actually a really, really good site if you want to, you know, experience the news in a more unbiased way, because it accumulates like what are all the other news sites saying, and then it gets the main point, and then it also, you know, gives you a brief description, and it gives you links to all of these all of the sites they took their info from. So it's like, it's a good way to, you know, stay unbiased, get the general idea, and, you know, fact check their, what they're saying. So it's a good site to use if you want to stay unbiased.
Okay. So it sounds like, by and large, what we're hearing is, from your generation, at least from this small sampling group that we have here at Conrad Weiser, you don't check the news all that particularly often. You take most of it with a grain of salt. You realize that most of it's given out of context, and you realize that a lot of it can be unreliable. So the question I pose to you is this: how do we fix that? How do we fix the media and fix the news cycle to help you get your information not just timely, but also factually and with context? What can we change about the way news is delivered to improve this?
So one of the great things about, you know, being in the free market is that the people can really, you know, make or break a product, and in this case the product being news. So as a consumer base, we have to, you know, we have to punish, like, you know, unbiased and, you know, misinformation by not even giving them the time of day, like not going to those sites or boycotting them. Because if, you know, news sites see that, hey, we can't mislead people, we can't, you know, clickbait them, we can't be biased anymore, it's gonna, especially once they start losing money, that's when the message goes through that, you know, we have to change our stance on this.
If the, go ahead. I have a follow-up, but go ahead.
Okay, I just wanted to, well, you might want to answer that first, but I just wanted to propose a question. Since you have more experience seeing the media change over time, I was wondering, where do you think that the media had dropped off at the point there that we couldn't really trust them? Like, where would you think that the point of the drop-off was, and then we can, like, experience that same news that we used to have again?
It's that's a good question. There's an argument to be made that the repealing of the Fairness Doctrine, which was done, if I'm not mistaken, by Reagan, but I'm a little my older politics are a little fuzzy, was the beginning of the downfall of media, so to speak, in that they were no longer required to give both sides in full context for their news. I have heard discussion that, you know, the removal of the Fairness Doctrine was kind of the instigation of the ability for something like Fox News to get through, where they just had some very strongly biased opinions one way or another. But I would also, in my personal opinion, I would argue that technology has definitely changed it a lot. When you can get your news instantly, without vetting, without fact-checking, without anything else, and as technology gets better and better about delivering it. So we've got how many ways to get our news right now? We've got, besides the feeds that come up on my watch, you know, you get your pop-ups on Twitter. It could be on Facebook. Just any kind of instant media is going to provide instant information. People can live stream stuff right away. So they might see an event occurring and just pop up their phones and start immediately broadcasting it. But the question is, when they do that, do we really understand what's going on, or are we just seeing events in action? And I'm not necessarily certain that I have an answer for how to fix it, because the best way to fix it, in my personal opinion, would be to slow it down. Time is of the essence here, and we need to slow down. We need to take our time. We need to take our information. We need to fill in all the gaps. We need to put it in context, and we need to be able to have time to digest it and actually think about it, instead of just going to the next item, the next item, the next item, and not really having any idea what's going on. It's just a barrage of information. So I think that the feeds are just getting too fast, but I also think that there's maybe not enough rules in place for how it has to be accurate. But what about you guys? What do you think?
So realistically speaking, I don't think it's ever going to get fixed, and I don't even know if at this point it can be fixed, because with the 2016 election, it was so insane because, I mean, Donald Trump is just such a character. And, you know, on the opposite end of the coin, you have Hillary Clinton who, you know, like there's so much there. It was so toxic in terms of like all the how politicized it got. And I feel like the news, like, you know, Jacob's right when he says it's all about the clicks. It's not necessarily about the facts, but it's how interesting you can make the story. So when you have something like that, and even now with Donald Trump as president, like, I feel like all the news and media sources, they're all freaking out. They're like, oh my gosh, there's so much content here. There's so much money we can make off this with clicks and stories and everything. And I don't know, because what I'm wondering, if maybe after, you know, maybe the next election or the next election after that, when Donald Trump eventually gets out, I'm wondering if it'll be, if all that political stuff will get maybe pulled back a bit and it won't be as toxic as it is. But from my viewpoint, like what I'm seeing, I don't think it will get better, because I'm looking at it right now. I feel like the news is more of a show now than it is actual facts and stories.
So let me put this out there. I might agree with you to a point that it couldn't be fixed in our current economic model. So let's drive into the future a little bit here, and let's go down, and I don't have a real timeline for this, but let's say 50 to 100 years from now, when the world has changed to such an extent with computers and automation and things are being done for us that we don't really necessarily need to be consumers anymore. If we were to remove economics from the equation, so that it's no longer about quantity and clicks, because we are a moneyless society for whatever reason, let's say, we'll go Star Trek-ish. And I know this is Star Wars Day, so that was a little blasphemy. Yeah,
more in the shirt.
is that maybe a possible solution, where consumerism is our problem and the removal of that might be the solution?
Yeah, I could see that. Without money, and you know, like I mentioned, maybe in the near future, things might get slowly. It will slow down, or slowly it will get pulled back. But you know, maybe because like it is a business. News is a business. I think same way as, you know, we're all film students, like filmmaking. It is a business first. It's not about, you know, just making cool movies. It's about making a lot of money. So in a society without, you know, money, economics taken out of it, you know, maybe it would be changed up a bit.
Okay. I felt like that was going somewhere. Oh, there we go. Hey.
Yeah, we are. So I would just like to say this. If we went towards, like, you know, a moneyless society where, you know, news isn't encouraged to make money off of clicks anymore.
Yeah.
I actually think news would become more biased. And
you
hear
think?
Me out.
Okay.
Because today the only thing stopping the news from being completely biased is the fact that they could lose consumers by, you know, making up stories or just being completely biased. And if we say 50 to 100 years from now, you know, we're moneyless, and, you know, I think the news would only be used, you know, to influence and to, you know, to make political statements. Because it's like, if you don't have to worry about, you know, losing your profit anymore, because there wouldn't be a profit in a moneyless society, then you don't have to worry about, you know, the quality of what you're saying. But again, to a fact, I think even today now, we're so advanced, like with, you know, cops have to wear body cams now, you know, drones are a thing. Like, pretty soon we're going to get, you know, like, we're not going to need people to get our news. So I think in the future, I think we're going to go towards like a more where us as people, as a population, will have access to the raw info. Like, instead of having to go through the middleman that is, you know, news media, we'll be able to make our own, you know, statements and claims on what's going on based off of that raw info that we're getting.
So if we were no longer a consumeristic society, though, what would be the incentive to be not truthful? Why would we want to not just be 100% honest all the time? If right now the sensationalism is what drives the clicks and drives the finance, if we removed that motivation, what drives the honesty of the news without that?
Well, human nature, because people are biased. That's a fact. Like, that's who we are. It doesn't matter which way you lean, you're going to be biased no matter what. Now, you know, the prospect of gaining money by eliminating that bias and, you know, trying to be truthful, that's originally what started, you know, media. It's like, how can I tell people a story and how can I make money off of this?
Okay.
Now that limit's getting pushed. I completely agree. I think people are heading towards, you know, what can we get away with while still making a profit? But you go 50 to 100 years, let's say CNN and Fox are like, you know, the two big conglomerates. CNN, obviously liberal, they're going to tell you liberal stories. Now, if they don't have to worry about making a profit, they can tell you whatever they want. Just for the sake of argument, let's say, you know, Trump and Hillary Clinton are like running in, you know, 2058 for president. CNN, they make up a story. Trump killed a kid. Trump, you know, hates puppies and all that. Guess what? Without you know, the prospect of money, like, or even the having to worry about being sued, because great, you're sued. What are they going to do? Take away your money? You don't have money. It's a non-consumeristic society. You can say whatever you want, and the same goes for Fox. Let's say, oh, Hillary Clinton is actually a lizard person. Here's evidence, but it's completely fabricated data. You know, without having to worry about money, there's no reason for them to not make up a story like that, because they're not losing anything if they lose people, if they lose, you know, a following. They're not losing any of those clicks or any of that.
Okay, that's an interesting
perspective. And they'll be driven solely based off of, like, you know, their ideals and their leanings. Like, it's... That's how I think it's going to be going if, you know, we go towards a more non-consumeristic society. But by the way things look now, I don't think that's at all happening. Everything today is about, you know, how can I make a profit?
Okay. Do I need to be concerned about the lizard people? I'm just asking.
I hopefully not, but, you know, in today's... Yeah, watch out for the suck. Yeah, anyone else have any opinions on this? Lewis.
I see what you're saying, Jake, like how they'll only be driven by their own ideals, but without money, I just, even with their own ideals, I don't see why they would need to use that to get as many people on their side as possible, because they're not going to gain anything from it, because it's still decided by, like if it's, say, the presidential election, like you're saying, as no matter how many people they have on their side, they still might not get, like, win the election, that they have the candidate that they want win the election, because people are just going to go out and vote for whoever they want, no matter what they believe. And I just, like, I don't think that they would report on something specifically because they, like, or only because that's what they believe. If they're going to bring news, they're going to want something from it. And if there's like not a guarantee that they'll get something from it, like right now it's money, but if we're living in a moneyless society eventually, then they're not going to get anything from reporting whatever they want. So I don't see why they would do, like, why they would report anything at all. And I think what you're saying about, like, how we're going to start being able to get the raw information on our own, I'd like just cut out news channels, news mass media completely. I think that's more along the lines of what's going to happen.
Okay. You don't think, even with the feed of the raw news, is there value, or at least I would feel like there might be, but I'm older generation, older school, in having somebody put that information together for us to present to us? See, when you say receiving the raw information, we can kind of get that now. With somebody's holding up a phone and watching a demonstration or a protest or, you know, a building burning down or something, we're getting raw information without context. So that's kind of already occurring, I think. But we still have to analyze that information and put it in context. And would that not still be true in the future?
I mean, it could be, yeah, but I think what Jake was saying, like with the drones and stuff and everything like that, we could have just like be able to see exactly what's happening as it's happening in context and everything, like just through our phones or whatever else gets invented.
I guess the only real issue then might be, which one do you watch? Because I would imagine with an entire planet and possibly more by that point, how do you decide? How do you decide what to watch if there's a million feeds out there?
Yeah, exactly. Can I just hear you phrase your question again? I think I have something to respond to it, but I just want to make sure I'm responding to the right thing.
That's going to require me remembering the question, which I think was, do we not still need somebody to take our raw feeds, the raw information, and put it in context for us to be able to absorb it?
Theoretically, we don't, but humans as a whole don't like to work if they don't have to. And, you know, looking at raw info and, you know, taking the time to come up with your own perspective on it, that takes time, that takes energy, and that's like, if we can delegate that to someone else, more likely than not, we're going to do that, because as a whole, people just don't like wasting their time. So do I think that's where we're going to head to? Maybe. But I think right now, the current model we have, you know, it's stood, you know, the test of time. Like, people have been giving, you know, news out since, you know, since the printing press. Mm-hmm. Like, so the whole idea that, you know, people are going to head towards a utopian-like society where there's no money and, you know, instant access to any news. Well, it's like, if we don't, like, what's going to be reported on then at that point? Like, the weather? It's like, we already look at the weather, so it's definitely an interesting dynamic to think about, but it's really hard to, like, predict what's going to happen in the near future.
I would agree with that. You can never see what's going to be coming forward, and anything can change it at a moment's notice.
I just also wanted to make a comment. I do believe that we're still going to have that bias, but it's coming from a different source. So, say not an anchorman or any news media, but say there was a fire and we get the raw footage from it. I believe we would get the information from the firemen or the police themselves, because that is their experience, and not an anchorman reporting on it. It's the firefighters in the police department reporting on them themselves. So I believe we will have raw footage from people that are around that area. It would be a little difficult to do that with, like, political affairs, because there would be a lot of bias around that, but smaller things that are local will be from the actual people themselves rather than anchormen.
Hmm. Okay.
That's my opinion.
Okay. Going back to one of the previous statements, which was kind of more along the lines of the default state of humans is to be lazy. That's paraphrasing a bit there, but would any of you think, and I know I'm kind of drifting a little bit off topic here, but do you feel motivated by a sense of accomplishment for whether it's reporting in news or anything, like your preferred thing? Would that not be enough motivation to do it if you wanted to build something, or if you wanted to play an instrument, or if you wanted to be a physician and heal people? Do you get enough of that motivation from the satisfaction of the accomplishments of helping other people? Or do you think our default state really is just to be as lazy as possible? Anyone?
So, I'm sure a lot of people feel amazing when they, you know, help someone out. And I guarantee you that's how a lot of, you know, anchormen and, you know, reporters, I bet that's how they feel too. They want the truth out there. However, you know, like, there are 7 billion people in this world. You're going to get a few million who are maybe even, like, hundreds of thousands who are into, you know, telling the truth. But overall, you know, as like, an entire population, I think you're going to find more people who don't really care enough, you know, to do anything about it than you are going to find people who do care. And I think that's just the way, you know, we are. That's human nature.
Okay. Are there any other perspectives on that?
I don't really have a different perspective. I agree with Jake. I think that while there would be some people that would want to do it just for the satisfaction, even if there was no money involved or any other incentive, like the satisfaction of getting the information out there, I just don't think that there's enough to make it a big enough movement without having an incentive like money or something like that.
Hmm. Okay. So we can't personally incentivize ourselves enough. The consumeristic model is what drives us. It seemed to be what I'm kind of getting out of this. Being able to buy stuff or be motivated by money.
Yeah, it's a tricky situation, because, you know, on one hand, you know, you know, we have this, you know, innate thirst for, like, knowledge and, you know, knowing what's going on. But on the other hand, you know, you have human nature where it's like, you know, do I really care about what's happening across, you know, the entire Atlantic or Pacific Ocean? It's like, if it doesn't affect me or, like, my immediate surroundings, why should I care? And I think that's what a lot of people think. However, you know, these you know, small things that happen across the pond tend to, you know, it has a rippling effect. You know, a small splash on one side of the pond eventually becomes a big wave on the other. So it's like, it's more of like just a perspective type of deal. Like, if this small thing over there might turn into a big thing over here.
Okay. A little bit of a butterfly effect. Okay. So we're going to be starting to wind down here a little bit, and I'm going to shift gears just a touch, kind of more from personal curiosity. For each of you, what is your favorite type of news? Do you particularly like to follow politics or maybe science or technology? Do you like to watch sports or world news or things like that? I'm just kind of curious across the board what you like. What's your interest?
Okay. Me personally, I love politics and I love science, you know, most, like, especially, like, space science. Like, I have been keeping up with, you know, the mission to Mars and, you know, SpaceX. I actually have on my personal laptop at home, I have something set up where it's, like, if something, like, involving SpaceX or, you know, a mission to Mars comes up, I get an immediate notice. So that's how into, you know, space I am. But with politics, I like to check on politics at least, you know, once a day. Because I would like to know, you know, because even something as small as, like a tax relief for farmers or something, like, that still affects, like, my area, because, you know, being in Pennsylvania, a lot of farms and all that. But I like to look at, like, what policies are being made and, you know, like, who's supporting them and, like, you know, how are the politicians being influenced, who donates to them and, you know, stuff like that.
Okay.
I'm definitely with Jacob on the space stuff. I think space is so interesting, and, you know, Elon Musk is such an interesting person. I love hearing what he's doing and everything. I want to be a film director when I grow up, so I follow a lot of movie news. I love seeing, you know, what's being made right now, what's going into production, who's writing what, who's acting in what, you know, who's dropping out of what project. I just think it's a lot of fun and really interesting to see. And it's also kind of funny because then people will be like, oh, this movie's coming out, I didn't know. And it's like, I knew for a couple months because I've been following it. But yeah, I'm really into that.
That's cool. Is it a safe bet most of you have seen or watched the Falcon Heavy launch?
Yes.
Yeah, I would assume.
Yes.
With Elon Musk shooting up his Roadster?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That was fun. I did watch that myself. Anybody else?
I am completely on board with Ethan there. Anything involving Elon Musk, I like to follow. I just think that his SpaceX adventures and ambitions with that are so cool. And I like to follow other sciences, like science stuff as well, science, technology, medicine, stuff like that. And I don't really follow politics all that much, but sometimes I try and get into it a little bit. I think mostly a lot of our generation doesn't follow politics too closely. I think it's more like science and technology and things we're interested in, things that we've grown up with. And we haven't grown up in a society that, like, really, I don't know, teaches kids to focus more on politics.
Right.
Or, like, raises them like that anymore.
That's kind of encouraging for me personally to hear all the interest in science and technology and in the arts. I actually, personally, I'm a musician in addition to being an engineer, so that's always fun for me. I actually went to school for percussion. So, anyway, who else? I think we've got a few more people over there, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, hi. So, news that I like to watch would be, like they all said, Elon Musk is really interesting, but science and technology and a lot of the new innovations that we're coming out with really catches my attention. And it's good to get away from politics, like everyday world affairs, and to see how we're making our world a better place instead of watching how we're making overall just a one big argument. So that's, I really like that.
That's cool. Yeah, I like that. I like the idea of progress rather than fighting. Yeah.
So I guess I'm going to be the only guy here that says sports.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, I mean, at school I follow up with politics and all the current news and stuff like that, but on my personal time I don't particularly like doing that. It's mostly sports. I love sports, watch sports, look up sports, find anything new about anything really. Like Ethan said, entertainment things, like new movies coming out, stuff like that I'm really interested in. We're all in a film class right now, TV, so anything involving that really interests me as well. But yeah, mostly just sports and like things I enjoy, like stuff that makes me laugh, like I said earlier on Twitter, and just things like that.
Try to keep the lighthearted side of it. I like that. Is anyone else going over there? So you're all in film class there. Is there a specific like a genre of the film that you, are you all learning the same thing or is it individualized? You're each learning your own thing.
Yeah, it's like, it's TV5, so it's like, you know, we're all, it technically it's independent study because, you know, not that many people make it, but okay. we all share the class. So it's, a lot of it's like individual projects because like our final project, it's like we get to pick what we want to make. So it's a really interesting thing to do.
Okay. That's cool. Do you, are you all hoping to be filmmakers, or are some of you thinking about like TV shows, or what all do you want to do? Anybody?
Yeah, I intend to go to college for film and video, and I intend to be like a director slash filmmaker. And we do a lot of film competitions. We just recently entered the 10-day film competition, and hopefully we'll be going to the screening day next week.
Oh, that's very cool.
We're still awaiting that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sam. Yeah, like I said earlier, I'm looking to be a film director. I'm going to college in Philadelphia for that. And yeah, that's it.
That's it. And we're good.
Yeah, what's really interesting about this class is that like it's not just directing, and you know, it's cinematography, it's you know, sound management and editing, which you know, I want to go into like film or media for editing because it's something I'm really passionate about, and I'm going to college for editing, which is really cool.
That is cool.
Well,
oh, yeah. No? Okay. So we're just about out of time here. I want to thank everybody there from Conrad Weiser from joining the conversation today. It's been very interesting and a little bit eye-opening. I'll definitely give you that. Any final comments before I wrap up here for anybody? Any thoughts or anything?
I would just like to say thank you for having us. You know, it's mm-hmm. it's great to you know have an opportunity to discuss you know what's going on in you know the world today and like. And I just have one more thing. Happy Star Wars Day, and may the 4th be with you.
We had to have it. Thank you very much for that. All right. Well, everybody good? Oh, yeah, very nice shirt. I definitely like that. All right, so you've been watching Bridging the Generation Gap with my guests from Conrad Weiser High School. Bridging the Generation Gap is on Fridays at 11 a.m., and we appreciate you tuning in here to BCTV, and we will catch you on the next episode. Thank you very much.
Bridging the Generation Gap is supported by Tompkins Vist Bank.